Jeg vil bare si velkommen. Jeg gleder meg utrolig mye til dette her.
Yes, men I think I'll do it in English because my Danish is a kind of mumbling and sometimes it's even hard for Danish to understand. So that might of course sometime make me search for a word, but then I'll take it in Danish and hope you will get it. And thank you for the invitation. And Melanie originally invited me to talk in the context of pedagogical discourses. I kind of, that's not my kind of cup of tea, because I think also from an artistic, institutional aspect, personally, as an artist, I find our artistic institutions important as artistic spaces, not as primarily as pedagogical or in the forthcoming structures, which I suppose you are also going to be hit by the universitarian transformation of the artistic traditions into something else. And that's something else I have problems with. So in that sense, I kind of, I would prefer to talk about something else. And and then I think we got, somehow we get to an agreement that I could talk about a special interest of mine, which is not my own work, but it is related to aspects of my own work. And perhaps I should say that basically I work in the field, in the expanded field of sculpture and installation, in a very broad sense. But I think as long as I have worked with or have been aware of the notion of art as we know it, then I have also had a parallel interest for other cultures' definition of artistic or aesthetic or cultural or visual space in the broadest sense of it. And one of these interests have correlated around for me, both highly aesthetic, intensive area, and also an area of broad cultural, historical interest, and that's the nomadic carpets from Central Asia. Yes. Laura, oh, hi. Yeah, perhaps you should try. Is this? Yeah. I would hate to stand over here all the time. Perhaps I try to speak louder without the. perhaps. Yeah, I don't know. Come over here. Then I have to. Does it help up here if I talk here? Okay, then I'll give something. Yes, back to this specific topic of textiles from Central Asia. Let's see. I probably have too many pictures here. I probably won't be able to show all of them to you, but I'll try. Because suddenly I get entangled in talking about something else. But I would like to show you at least this string of possible views into something which is very specific, but also in my mind also bear resemblance to some aspects of the core structure of what visual, artistic, cultural transformations and relations might contain. Then it. Yeah, then it must.
So, okay, sure. Good.
My area of interest regarding these specific carpets, I have a few samples down here. Later you can come down to touch them if you would like, because of course pictures do not do this stuff justice. It's a tactile and a visual tradition. Central Asia, regarding the carpets, specific these carpets, that's 2 meters then. And as you can see, it's with good reason that it's called Central Asia, because it's kind of in the middle of it all. If one looks at it in a historical perspective and a geographical perspective, then Central Asia is placed in a cross section between two different structures of cultures. The one culture is located in the green area up here. That's called the Eurasian steppe. It's kind of a special geographical feature which stretches from, as you see, China into Europe. It's kind of a slightly, perhaps, underestimated structure within also our own history of civilization. Actually, this constitute a cultural highway. A nomadic tribe were able to move along this plateau, living as nomadic tribes, and in times of, as we also know it historically, war. We have Genghis Khan, who within 2 or 3 years first established a tribe of 10 or 5 tents, and these tents they gather the complete Mongolian nation, and within 2 or 3 years Genghis Khan has established one of the largest empires which the world has ever seen. And that was, I don't remember the time, I think it was 11th century, sorry. A lot of these dates I'm going to say, and some of the names, forgive me, they might be wrong. But take it in the broad picture. But you can imagine, starting out in 2 or 3 tents, within 3 or 4 years, Genghis Khan had established a complete coherent structure of government, going from the Altai Mountains in central Mongolia all the way into Poland and further on. Of course, Genghis Khan wasn't the first, he was just kind of the most known nomadic tribe which has traveled this route. Probably the route is stretching back parallel to the urban cultures, or even older, which, as I hope you know, start out around here, around Indus, Tigris, Euphrates, and of course the Nile in Egypt. My point in this is that the steppe nomadic culture established a route, a very mobile route, where you were actually able to travel also as both as a tribe and as a family within a few years the complete distance of Asia. And it happened, not all the time, but it happened. South of this steppe, we have a division mostly constituted by mountain regions and rivers going south and north, of course. But along the southern border of the Eurasian steppe, there is a system of urban cultures, which you can see on the lower map, And these cultures, urban cultures, they constitute the trade route which in late Romanticism gets the name the Silk Road. That's the transportation route of also silk. That's how silk got from China to the Roman Empire. That was during trade routes along this system. It's a rather wrong notion, this notion of one road. But it is a geographical constitution of a network of trade between cities and cultures, which has both delivered and transformed various aspects of both culture, techniques, and also religious and metaphysical notions have been exchanged during this route of cultures and urban structures. There has been a continuous both peaceful exchange but also a violent exchange between the nomadic cultures and the urban cultures. There has been migration east-west along this route, and there has certainly also been migration north-south during this route. The reason why the Central Asian region is especially interesting, it is because it constitutes a direct, because of geographical reasons, the area between the Caspian Sea, Aralsøen, and Amur-Darya. It constitutes an open area where the nomadic people were able to, from time to time, to travel en masse into Persia, Iraq, and later also Turkey, and all the way up to Europe. So, and the migration had also been, probably also in prehistoric times, been active as a dynamic between the agricultural, urban civilization south, and then the nomadic tribes. Sorry, it's far too time, much time. Then I want to go further. Now, that was actually perhaps a more detailed map of what could be the Silk Road. You know, there are these stories also about Roman decadence, where actually the Roman Republic have to put limitations on the use of the Romans for their silk dresses, because it was simply too expensive for them, and they didn't really have anything of value which they could exchange except gold and silver. So it was kind of draining the financial system in the Roman Empire, at least for periods. So. But now I want to go a bit further into the Turkmen carpets, because there is also an interesting, more recent history in it, which is also a story about it's a story about imperialism and and capitalism and the destruction of culture, unfortunately. This is the Russian Empire we have here, and then we have the expansion of the Russian Empire, which first, and I think it's already Peter the Great, who takes Siberia, and then later on Caucasus in the 17th century, and then in the 18th century, the Russian imperial ambition has been to get a harbor to the Stillehavet, Arabian Sea, or whatever, because Russia, of course, lacks access to the sea. They only have it through the Balticum, and are lacking harbors for its further expansion of its empire. Then they hit a rather tough competition from the British Empire. That's called historical. It's called the Great Game. The British Empire, they won't accept that Russia expand its borders to the south. So the British Empire does everything it's in its power to stop the Russian expansion south. So the Russian, they kind of stop up here in the border of between Iran and Turkmenistan. But along that fight, the Russian, they bumped into the nomadic tribes, the Turkmen nomadic tribes, which were still highly efficient culture, which were also able to make a serious resistance towards the Russian Empire. The Russians, to make their military machine efficient, they did as all empires do. They built infrastructure to carry supports, weapons, soldiers, and guns, and later on tradesmen and developers. But the poor Russians, they ended up in Göbeklitepe. That's the last stand of the Turkmenian people, where they lose. Of course they lose. They can't fight an empire, but they put up a serious resistance. This is, as you can see, it's of course a Russian painting of the situation. The Russians, they end up in Turkmenistan, having conquered it all in 1871, I think it is. That's this battle, that's the final stand of the tribes. And then they can't go further. Then they sit in a territory which doesn't really have any resources. There's not much to develop. There's no minerals. The urban structures are rather decayed for various reasons, which I forgot to mention before. Perhaps I could get. Sorry, it's wrong. I have to come to the cards. But the problem is that the Russians, they need to do something in this area. They look for value to. They have to cover their costs, of course, war costs, so you have to somehow profile. There's nothing except for one thing, and that's carpets. There are these fantastic, marvelous carpets which are made by the tribes. The first thing the Russians, they do, it is they steal all the carpets. They take them all. They empty every yurt or buy them for nothing from a people who is hungry and defeated. So they take all of it and they move it to Moscow and sell it, and then it goes into interior decorating, Biedermeier tradition in a Europe context. And second from that, they see, okay, now we have taken it all, we have to make something new. So they start putting the carpets into production. They establish schools and they establish cartoons. They draw up the patterns, deliver them for production. They deliver machine, spun yarn and weaves. Already, this is around 1880, already in 1890, the other thing they of course do, that is to kill all the horses. All the nomadic tribes' horses, after this battle, they are put to death. They're piles of burning horses. That's destroying, of course, the basic nomadic infrastructure, their mobility, their possibility of both making warfare, but also their possibility of sustaining their nomadic traditions. And their nomadic traditions, of course, are based on sheep and taking care of the sheep and systematically driving them around in specific areas which are highly controlled and organized by the tribal structure. But all of that, that doesn't fit into the new imperial structure. Too much mobility, which potentially leads to resistance and warfare. So kill it, stop it, kill the horses and make people move into towns and then go to schools. my point was that already a generation of, not even a generation, but 20 years after, in 1891, there are documented complaints from Moscow telling the authorities in Turkmenistan the carpets do not have the quality they should have. And it makes sense, they have destroyed the very basic of the carpets. And it both goes for their materials, and it also goes for their patterns and their iconography. And I'll try to show you some examples of this. This is a German carpet from the Tegu tribe. It's probably around 1800, might be older. There are some specific ornamental qualities by which you kind of divide them into different areas. This has a very spacious and a very broad definition of the patterning. And here you can see that's same guy, probably 1800. Might also be one of the fantastic things about the Central Asian Turkmen tribes carpeting. I forgot to say that in the start. That's of course also one of the aspects why I, as an artist, is interested in this stuff. It is also as a kind of a correlate to our own notion of what is art and what is an aesthetic practice. We are totally involved in a specific authorship of the artistic notion, and that's the individual subjective genius who is transforming a history into a critical breakdown into something new. This is a representation of something which is more or less the complete opposite. It's a collective, repetitive, anti-subjective aesthetic tradition. A carpet like that, as I said, it could be from 1800, but it could also be from 1650. Kind of the same. The girls, and this is a woman's art in Turkmenistan, it's a matriarchal artistic space. They have been meticulously repetitioning the pattern, and of course with small transformations and small variations, but never in the intention of bringing a special authorship from a singular individuality. On the contrary, it has been a collective notion of identity and tribal value. So, yeah. But 1800 and something, I suppose here around I would complain if I was in Moscow, because this ain't good. You can see the pattern going down. What you can see is that the quality of the wool and the shine and the material is terrible. I suppose some of you may even know these cars. They lie around and we use them, and they have their life and their reality also as a modernistic feature in the interior development. You know. This would still be kind of okay. Not something which has any. I'm also involved in a special branch of fetishizing pre-industrial aesthetics, but this is not made for a tribal structure. This is made for the European or the Western market. This is made as a family's pride and identity within a tribal structure. It's probably 1930, 1940. If you take a closer look, you can see some of the patterns are, of course, still there, but totally destroyed. One of the way the Russian came about the deterioration of the carpets. That was to say, you have to weave them finer. You have to put more knots into them. You have to make them finer so they have some kind of quality. But putting more knots into the carpets, that meant that the patterns were getting smaller and details were lost because remember, none of the weavers actually had any of the old carpets. The old carpets were gone again generation or two generations before. They were already in Moscow. So the young girls, they only had these rather bad cartoons of the carpets to reproduce once again and again and again. Mm-hmm. Yes, sorry. Okay. Here you see a family, a part of a family, sitting in their own situation. There are not very many records of how the Turkmen people actually lived. We have to be a bit angry at the Russian Empire compared to the English and German Empire. The English and Germans, they always send missionary after their warriors. And these missionary, they had kind of also an ethnographical interest. The Russian only sent the warriors and the soldiers, sorry, and then they didn't make any records at all of what they were destroying. Of course, I'm kind of joking. Hope you get it. But this means that there is actually almost no documentation of either how the original carpets were made or what they might have meant in their own cultural context. Luckily, there is one Russian anthropologist who makes a serious study in the 1930s, and she kind of collects whatever information there still is regarding the context and the names and the tribal belongings to the different patterns. She also described the main functions of a lot of these carpets, and the main function is evolving around bridal ceremonies, where you have the bridal ceremony is a rather elaborate exchange within the tribal structures between families and yurts. Yurt, that's a tent they live in, these round tents. So there's a highly elaborate cultural ceremonial exchange going on in the bridal ceremony, and as a part of this structure, the bride is being relocated from one family to another, and in this relocation she brings in symbolic gestures of her own value, and that value is delivered in the form of the finest weavings that the Turkmen people made, and that was generally in these small formats. They were normally made in pairs, two small carpets like this, and then they were not only for decoration or whatever, or identity, they were also utilitarian pieces, which were bags. They are bags. There's a bagging at them. So they also inherently, as objects, dealt with the issue of them being nomadic. They were transportable, and they were containers, and they were containers of utilitarian goods, but also of tribal identity and iconography. These photos, why they're interesting, you can see them, they are kind of a blur and the colors are mashed out, but they are actually the oldest existing color photographs. They are taken between 1800 and 95 and 1900 by a Russian photographer who traveled around all the empire, and then he had developed a camera with four different glass plates. That's why they are blurred within the
they had to be, they had to sit quiet for 5 minutes, but the carpets are kind of not moving. So they get, but they are among people who look at this, there are a lot of discussions if something like this could be taken serious, because it is obviously staged, but it is staged because it is a photograph which has the limitation of the people have to sit there for 5 minutes. So they have, of course, put on their beds clothes, and probably the photographer has also asked them to put on their most authentic clothing and stuff like that. So there's an element of theater, but there is also an element of truth in his photos. Here's a family sitting outside, and they have a not very good carpet, but a good carpet in front of their yurt. And I can't really see them, but they look they look rather sad, even though they're dressed up beautifully. And as you see, the old guy, he has Russian orders. It's also the Tekke tribe. The Tekke tribe is one of the most documented, because they were the largest tribe at the time of the Russian conquest. The yurt is a tent structure, round tent structure, instead of that, basically there are two different nomadic systems of tents. There's the yurt, which is round and built up around a wooden self-carrying structure, and then there's the black tents, which goes from Tibet and then all into Africa and Sahara. The yurt, the round tent that kind of goes from Turkmenistan, also part of Tibet, and then all the way into Mongolia. Perhaps a slightly better photo, so it might actually be younger than the other one. You can see some of the carpets. Okay, this one is actually very close to the one I have here. It's also a bag, a larger bag. If you go up later and see, you can see it's constituted of both a flat weave and then pile weave. And there are also some elements of silk, which has been very expensive for nomadic people, but they use them sparsely and in specific areas. Tuval, Mafraj, Salor, Tuval. Yeah, all the bags have different names and different, there are different types, and they are as rigid as the main carpets. The same formats of carpets have been produced for at least 400 or 500 years. That's the oldest one we got, but they are probably older than that. This might also be an interesting sample, because there are elements in these carpets which I see as purely nomadic tribal identity, but then there are also elements of something else. There is also exchange to the urban cultural structures, and this one I think is a rather interesting possible example. I took a, what is called a forbehold. Please be cautious, both with the numbers, years I say, but also some of the things I say. Most of them are actually interpretations. Perhaps I should add, before I start with all my interpretations, I'll make a small beware. Because that's also one thing I find highly interesting about the carpets. It is that they are, as I said, very badly described as ethnographical objects. The university structure, for some reason, haven't really taken serious interest in them as cultural objects. And I suppose partly because they have been dealt as interior decorating, and their main distributors have been carpet dealers, and carpet dealers, they are even worse than people who will sell you an old car. They will say anything to you to get you to buy the carpet. And so the main bulk of the literature about the carpets, it's made by carpet dealers, and people who have a very specific interest in some aspects, and most of it is totally good. And I'll show you a really funny example. First, good, very good. Turkmen Studies number one. It's an anthology made in, I think it's made in 1980, which is specific about the Turkmen tribes, and it kind of tried to grasp different aspects of them in an anthology form. Some are very deep, some are very superficial, but it's kind of a broad investigation of the Turkmen rocks. And this is a, this special sample, it's fantastic, it's beautiful, but it's a carpet dealer in Copenhagen. He simply had these carpets he wanted to sell, but he was a great carpet dealer. There are many who are very bad carpet dealers who put anything into this. Then there's this one. This might be interesting. That's my point. I don't know if any of you are interested in carpets or have a slight interest in carpets. There's a very, very huge possibility that you have run into it. It's a Taschen book, so it's of course in it's of course in English, it's in German, it's in Russian, it's in Italian, it's in France, and probably something more. And it's not only that, so it's a huge amount of beautiful, beautiful, fine historical rocks that you get for very, very cheap paid. But if you get it, then promise me one thing, don't read the text. The text, that's a monstrous, disastrous fantasy. And apart from that, do you know what it is? No. Does anyone know what it is? No. It's made by a person who is named Volkmar Ganson. It's a doctoral thesis, and a doctor, he got a doctoral degree in Leipzig on this text at the Art Academy in Leipzig. And it's, I promise you, it's not only me who's saying it. Everyone I know, and everything I can find, people who know anything about the carpets, they say, buy it for the pictures, it's nice pictures. It's a doctoral thesis and a doctor grad in the carpets, and it has one point which is evolving all his interpretation and thinking about, and that is that the Oriental carpet is in its origin a Christian carpet. He sees and it's a nutcase. and he he sustained his hypothesis with every time he sees a cross, then it's not just a cross, it's a Christian cross. Carpets are made like this, you know. They are made structurally by this. There's no way around that crosses happen all the time. If you see half a cross, then it's half a cross, and of course, therefore, also Christian. At first, I was totally what's happening here? This is impossible. This can't be right. Then I looked a bit further into it, and then to my relief, I got to understand what had happened. Volker Ganzmann is an artist. He's an artist. He's a painter. Of course he is, like me, or like you. He has simply taken the liberty to make a totally subjective interpretation, which is nuts, and then he has taken it to Leipzig, shown it to someone who knew nothing about the rocks, and then he is now a doctor in the carpets, and Taschen is circulating this, and he's getting medallions in Armenia and other areas, Christian areas in post-Soviet, because there's an agenda here. So it's just to say that it's a very open area for interpretations, and I'll bring some up here, and some of them might be as crazy as Ganzhorn's, but so that was just a precaution for you. But take a look at this. Don't they look rather identical? This is
Russian Imperial Rokoko uniform, probably. Once more, yeah.
Let's probably, om vi kan få lidt ud igen.
On the left, a beautiful military Rokoko Soviet uniform. You see the two eagles up there. The two eagles up there, that's another story, but they can be traced also all the way down to Mesopotamia and stuff like that. So Russia is in an old contact and dialogue with this stuff. But my proposal here is that sometimes around, this is Rococo, so this is probably 1730-40, the Russians are down in Caucasus. They probably have lost a few of these beautiful uniforms to some tribal people and some battles. And then this one over here, that's a sirfa. It's a traditional Turkmen weave. Do you know what it's for? Can you see it? It's because it's kind of impossible to see if you do it. It's a headdress. It's put over the head. So there are no that these sleeves for the arms, they are artificial. You can't put your arm into. Oh, sorry. Let's see. Oh, no, it's probably I want to show you some more pictures. But these are four sleeves. They are arms. They are kind of decorative feature. But I suggest that they might come from somewhere else. They could come from something else also. But it's just kind of the yurt. I know I have to speed up. I have a lot because I haven't even started yet. Sorry. Let's see. Yurt. A special spatial structure which, if you're born and raised within this kind of structure, spherical structure, completely embodied within textiles. Textiles which bear all your cultural identity, then you have another frame set then if you're born in this. This is Samarkand, it was always Tashkent, but this is the urban structure of Central Asia. There was a continuous dialogue between these urban centers where some of the colors here, the main color of all the carpets, it's red, and it is for good reasons, it's a matter. Krabler, it's called in Danish. It's a plant which grows all over the Eurasian steppe, so it has been something which simply could have been digged up along the road. But the blue color here, that's you know it from if you have cowboy books, that's indigo. So it's a traded color which have come from the cities to the tribal. The Turkmen tribes, they have no written language, they have no metallurgy, they have no, of course, no writing, and they have no architecture. They collect all the visual aesthetics within a rock to make something like this. It's a very long road from the sheep to this. They have accumulated both all the infrastructure, their family structure, their economy, their food, and their trade, and also their marriage, their interchange of tribal identity into these peaks of objects. They have, if they should be translated into to financial value in the tribal structure, then they would involve a sum of both monetary and cultural identity, which is extremely hard. But when the nomadic tribes they went in and out of the dialogue with urban societies, then they also exchanged these values both culturally and aesthetically. And from time to time, the tribal people they even conquered some of the Khanates and
city states. This is from Kiva, where you have a beautiful palace, which is mainly structured around open gore yards. And then in two or three of the yards, there are these representational situations where instead of a throne or whatever would be the outmost representation for the local khan, then you have a plateau for a yurt. And not even that, you also have the yard is also transformed to a kind of a, not a garden, but an open area with one tree, one bush, kind of an representational articulation of the hierarchy in the state. The tents themselves have a structure, which also might, some of this one could say, these structures in Europe or elsewhere might have evolved into architecture, but in the Turkmen and in Turkic tradition, then we end up having a very direct relation between the structure of the dwellings and the textiles, kind of made in the same basic techniques but with different materials. Sheeps can't have wools or carpets without sheeps, domesticated sheeps. They're not that old. I think they are only around 8,000 years old. So it's not a kind of a Neolithic culture. It's 8,000 years max. The skin, I just showed some basic keeling. That's the most basic weave, and it's of course a kind of weave which almost, it does appear all around the globe. It's not dependent on a specific culture. We have it, Eskimos have done something similar, also in South America we have it, so it's not specific. But this is kind of, now we get a bit more specific, because this is knot weaving. This is small knots bound within the keeling, and it kind of gives the textile hair. It's called pile weaving. And you, of course, know it's soft because it has hair. These are some of the oldest fragments. They are found in the Tarim Basin. It's now in China, but it's a desert area where there were urban cultures, but they have been destroyed by climate reasons. And there's kind of an interesting, some aspects of the weave. This is also my suggestion, there's no evidence for it at all, but the oldest weavings might be mimetic regarding the sheep, that you simply kind of do the sheep, but do it artificially. This one is not very old, but it's interesting because it also can perhaps mimic the shape of the sheep. Culturally, the nomadic tribe, they are an animistic, shamanistic religious tradition. These days it's called Tengrianism. Tengra being the sky god and mountain god. But there is a shamanistic tradition which goes all along the Eurasian steppe from Mongolia. These days it's still alive, it takes shapes like this somewhere around, don't remember quite where. You see the sheeps everywhere, and also these horns are from, I can't remember its name, but it's a wild goat, which is probably the ancestor of the domesticated sheeps. It still lives widely in all of Asia. And is hunted, and the horns are revered on it. All the way up to Finland, you know, our neighbors, the Sami, they have had up to this tradition, up to last century, they have a living shamanistic tradition, down to Tibet. Look at some of the iconographies, there are direct relations. Look at the hat of the, this is a Scythian, old Scythian, that's what's that, that's 500 before BC. Scythian culture was a large Eurasian culture. And then from one of the oldest burials, Scythian burials in the Altaj region, that's Pasaryk, the Pasaryk burial, where there were these fields. Some of these border iconographies, they are totally still alive as core identificators of Turkic culture. This is kind of, this, and of course, Mr. Ganson, he would say, "Oh, it's Christian. It's a cross. There must have been." And he doesn't care that it's 500 before Christ. He doesn't get into that. this is still alive. This is still alive. Look at the. That's kind of basic Turkic iconography, and it is the sheep. The sheep is a very basic icon for a nomadic sheep-based culture. So this is probably the male sheep, which stands for vitality and reproduction and wealth and stuff like that. And then it has the red color. You can see it all over the Turkmen carpet. It's a motif which hides in all details. At one time, you have a better view of this. Is an older, much older, but probably not Turkic. It's Achaemenian, so it's older and something else. But the point is just simply that the sheeps themselves are iconographic motifs within the carpets. Birds. That's a very basic, also shamanistic tool for transmitting spiritual integration and information from the spirit world. So birds, tons of birds. This is the Marbjörk. It's located in Sweden. It was found, I think it was found a couple of hundred years ago, but it's from the 15th century. It has been in a church in Sweden since the 15th century. And it's obviously Caucasian. All the details, the borders, there's no detail, nothing. So there has been what's called acceptance, and it has been valued, and it has been transported, and it has been able to actually be in a church in Sweden for 300 or 400 years. So it's not something new that there is this interaction between. That's I forgot to say that. I should have perhaps framed it all. That's also a part of my interest in these rocks. It is also because I think they might give us suggestions to seeing our culture and ourselves not only as isolated individuals, but actually as actors within a grid of exchange and value. Appreciation and interconnections, a web of connections between and across borders. We couldn't have a Western civilization if we didn't have the infrastructure of both the Silk Road and the Eurasic steppe. It would have been impossible. We wouldn't have had bronze, we wouldn't have had iron, we wouldn't have had writing, we wouldn't have had our notions of religion, and we certainly wouldn't have had any textiles or probably not even architecture. Marbjörk, beautiful rock, not very big. Take a look. Tree and two birds, mirrored across an axis and mirrored across an axis. Yeah, that's very important for the Turkmen rocks. Around 1800, Karapalak, a northern Turkmen tribe. See the same kind of mirroring of the animistic motifs. Now it's very important. See, this is a very, very minuscule motif. This is like this. It's a Tekke tribe. Their specific tribal god, Tuvalgon. And if you take a look at it, then you can see if you remember the Marbjörk rock. Tree and you have two words out there. So you have the core, some core iconography, which is animistic, probably also shamanistic. The Turkmen people were first converted to Islam in the 18th century. So they are rather late converters to Islam. Of course, the urban cultures, they were they converted to Islam already around 400, 600 to 600 around there. But the tribal system, they kind of kept on doing what they had always done. So, and this is some of my interpretations here. But what you see here is your iconography, which is the same as the Mabi work. Let's see if I can find it. Two birds and they're mirroring along an axis, probably the world axis. And that's also a very common shamanistic notion that when you move around, you establish a center. Each time you establish the yurt, you establish the center for the family and the center for the clan and the center of the world. So the world axis, I suppose you have heard about it. It's a basic religious iconography. And we have our own, of course, we have Yggdrasil in our own culture before we got Christianized. And the cross mark also, the world tree, is also articulated.
It's not like that, yeah.
Yes, our own cross might also by some religious branches be talked about as the tree of life, stuff like that. So a tree is something very centering for a cultural identity, especially for a nomadic people who live in an area where there are no woods. So it has kind of been a metaphysical tree which has been a centering of the world, both as identity and as spirituality. I assume I need a cigarette. But if you isolate the motive of the possible shamanistic iconography, then there's something else. And that else you see out here, that's kind of very basic filling of geometries. And this kind of filling of geometry, that is very basic Islamic establishing of patterning. So you get a very, very concrete exchange within the center of the Turkmen god between shamanistic iconography and Islamic geometrical pattern making. And probably also perhaps the notion of, what's it called? The shamanistic tribes are hiding their iconography within a grid of geometry. Oops. Sorry. I'm going the wrong way. And here, in the large carpet, you also have the same kind of a centered tree and a small an animal figuration within the god. But it's of course a bit clearer to see the Islamic tile patterning. This is a conventional tile patterning that has evolved in Persia, Islamic Persia. Probably some might argue that the Persian learned it from the Turkmens, but that's kind of for hardcore Turkmen carpet dealers. I suspect that the Turkmen got the grit from the urban structure. And also when you look at them, none of them are, of course, actually geometrically correct. They are kind of adapted. They are adapted visually to an elastic notion of geometry. There's no true geometry in them, except, of course, from the basic mirroring of axes. That's also a part of the general notion of how to establish pattern, and they might have shared that. Again, the iconoclasm of Islamic culture, it has kind of two branches. one branches which focuses on the scripture of the Quran and says nothing else but the scripture. Scripture and perhaps ornament, but scripture, that's it. That's a hardcore fundamentalistic. Sorry, I don't remember the dates, but this goes up to around 600, this kind of tradition. And it's also in Turkmenistan or in Uzbekistan and the urban cultures. We have this articulating of calligraphy, scripture, which is religious, around a void of nothingness, of ornamentation. The Central Asian tribes, when they were, and also the urban cultures probably, when they converted to Islam, it was probably, I think it's, now I say that it's probably, but if you ask me what's my source, I would have to go into some of these not very reliable books. But it is common agreed that the Turkmens, when they accepted Islam as a religion, it was by the interference and by the missionary of Sufi branches of the Islamic tradition. And the Sufis are traveling guys like this. And this is a Timurid painting, miniature painting from around 1100. So it's probably this kind of Islamic notions, which were mainly born by storytelling and by paradoxes and tellings and by individual mystics, not by the Quran and not by building mosques and madrasas and stuff like that. So the Sufi tradition, because it were born by individuals who walked and talked, and so it was kind of able to be absorbed within the nomadic structure probably. So around the 10th century, a specific branch of the Turkmen tribes in Central Asia called the Seljuk, they conquer first Persia, then all of Iraq, and then they conquer most of Turkey. They don't take all of Istanbul and Byzance, but the main chunk of all Turkey are being conquered by nomadic tribe. These tribes, they go in, they take the leadership of the country, and they are at that point also the one who goes into both Persia and to Turkey. They also adapt to Islamic religion, but they keep their own level of power within the structure of the nomadic people, and then they kind of take the urban techniques and the urban economies and use them for and sustain them and keep. So it's kind of only the upper class of both Persia and Turkey and Iraq which gets exchanged by these nomadic conquerors. But both the artists and the architects and the general people kind of stay there. So they get a mixture the other way around than we have seen before the Turkmen tribe established themselves as ruling classes in both Persia and Turkey. One of the things it actually does it is that because the Turkmen tribe, they are rather liberal regarding the interpretations of the Quran because they are Sufi oriented, then they relax regarding the iconoclastic aspect. So that's why we have Timurid and Ilkhanid miniatures. We have realistic paintings which we didn't have before. So it's kind of a new ruling class which has a liberal engagement with Islam, which But it's these carpets, Timmerwood carpets, they are only survived in the miniatures, not as a main motive, but as a part of the scenography of presenting nobility and people. This is the only fragment which has survived, but you can recognize the basic pattern, and you can also hopefully recognize the mixture between possible Islamic tile ornamentation and something else. Another very, very interesting chunk of carpets, that's this one, it's the Chilluk carpets. If you go to Istanbul or to Istanbul, Antalya, but mostly in Istanbul, the Carpet Museum, they have I think they have 7 or 8 of these carpets. They were found around 1910 by a Swedish guy in collaboration with a German guy, or in competition with a German guy, in a mosque in central Anatolia. And they were found archaeologically found within a mosque. They have been placed in the mosque in Chilluk time in 1150 or something. They have been given to the mosque as gifts to the mosque, and then they had slowly been covered by other gifts. So they appeared because someone started to look what's beneath. And that means that this collection, that there actually exists a collection I think if you put all the samples together, there are around perhaps 20 different carpets, which then is the first group, oldest group of carpets it is possible to look at. There are older carpets like the Pasuruk carpets, but that's a singular one, so it's difficult to put it into context. But the Chilluk rocks are interesting because they are a group, so you can actually compare and see how they relate and somehow establish a stylistic and a iconographic discussion. I have some discussion around them, but time is running. I think I need a cigarette. Do you have any? I need a cigarette, and then I come back if you would like to. Yeah. Chaos. If we have some chaos, yeah, det er sikkert lidt for mig.
Men det kunne du godt være med,
ja. Og nu skal lige holde øje med den der. Jups. Den er rigtig interessant. Det er et motiv, der er diskuteret siden tæpperne blev fundet. Specielt den udgave, som vi ser der. Det er kantmønstre, der sidder ude i kanten af tæppet. Ja, det er en lang historie, men nu skal jeg se, hvad den går. Men det der, det er også for mig at se en sammensmeltning af shamanistisk ikonografi og islamisk kalligrafi. Og det er et postulat, og det vil folk nok bestemt ikke være enige. Men nu skal jeg prøve, om jeg kan løse den op for jer. Springer lige frem. Det her, det er et af de chilukiske tæpper, der også blev fundet i moskéen. Lige fra man så det først, så har man sagt, at det der ude i kanten, det ligner kufisk. Kufisk, det er den officielle, ornamentale, islamiske koranskrift. Når man bare kigger på det sådan hurtigt overfladisk, det ligner kufisk. Man kaldte det pseudokufisk. Pseudokufisk er så også en særlig type ornamentik, som vi også har i Europa. Den sidder også ved kanten. Måske det der er det chilukiske tæppe også. I kan se mønstret to gange. Nej, det kan jeg ikke lige se. Der. For mig set, så er det der både det ornament, I så før, men så er det også en anden figuration. Mit postulat, det er det, der er på fælder, det er også telt. Det er et stykke nomadisk arkitektur i Lurden. Lurden har en central pæl. Så har den så to blomster eller mennesker. Der er et glidende forhold mellem menneske. Det her faktisk også, de her der sidder hernede, de er selvfølgelig både træer, og så er de vederhorn, men deres turminske navn, det er også de dansende piger. Så der er sådan et glidende forhold mellem floral ikonografi, animal ikonografi, og så antropomorfisk ikonografi. Men sådan meget neddæmpet. Jeg er ikke i tvivl, det er to personer, der står inde i bordet. Men så er det andet, det der. Det der, som man før kaldte kufisk. Det er klassisk kufisk, tidlig kufisk, østlig kufisk, det der så hedder foliet, ornamenteret kufisk. Så kommer der square kufisk, som er mest i keramik. Og så er der en ornamenteret kufisk til. Alle de der tre gange, der står et ord, det er ordet Allah, Gud. Så jeg påstår, at den der lille ornamentfigur, I så ude i den første, det er en slags ornamenteret kalligrafi, hvor dem, der har kigget på det, de har sandsynligvis ikke kunne læse, og det har væverne sandsynligvis heller ikke, men de har ikke været i tvivl om, at det er sakralt. Den er også fundet i måske. Her kan I se sammenligning mellem det første, foliated, ornamented kufik og square kufik. Alle ornamenterne er fra de geologiske tæpper. Man kender så også det, der så er diskussionen i tæppeverdenen, det er, står der noget, eller står der ikke noget? Er det kufisk, eller er det pseudokufisk? Er det ren ornamentik, eller er det skrift? Og det synes jeg er en pseudodiskussion, fordi tæpperne, de hører til i en ikke-skriftlig kultur, men de er stadig, eller det er reduktionistisk at sige, at et tegn, nu snakker jeg dansk, sorry. Semiotically, it's kind of redundant and reductional to make a difference between writing and ornament. Because these carpets are produced and are cultural identities within a non-written culture. It is an Islamic culture and it is an urban culture where the Quran and the Muslim tradition is built out around an ornamentation of written language. So in my heart there's no doubt that there is a transmission between the ornament and the writing. So my suggestion. This is my own card. And it actually says Allah down in this border, and that's it says Allah, or it says some form of a religious statement. This is conventionally called the cubic border. You can perhaps recognize the cubic out here and the pure ornamentation within it. It's also found in Timurid tradition, where it is undoubtedly intermingled with writing. It's sorry, I can't remember, but it's from the Quran, the Declaration of Faith. If you look at the relations, there is a fluent development between pure ornament and writing. This is written kufik. Some of the written kufik is very, very complex. In Denmark, we have one museum which is specialized in the Islamic arts, and that's David's collections. When they need someone to read kufik, they get a specialist from England. There's no one in Denmark who can do it. Something like this is possible to read, but it can be very, very complicated. How the Islamic texts are written in ornamental cubing. The totally funny thing is this. I suppose you know the prayer carpet, or if you don't, it's a very basic carpet in our tradition. When you perform your prayers in Islamic culture, you are situated on a clean space. It isn't necessarily a carpet. It could be anything, but it has to be clean. But at least in Anatolia and in Turkey, the prayer rock is abandoned all over. it's a very and it's it has also a very direct relation to orientalistic interior decorating interests from the West. A lot of them has probably been produced for the West, so you could get something oriental, you could get a prayer carpet. But they have also been used as a part of very early Islamic tradition. Take a look at this, the ornament, which might have been a religious ornamentation of the word Allah. It transforms itself, going out in the prayer of and becoming a nisha, a mirab. The architectural feature which points towards Mecca, where in which direction you have to point your prayers. So writing becomes iconography as architecture. If you see number three, then the nisha becomes the mosque. You have the dome and you have the minarets. And that's a side branch also, but it's interesting. Look at how the moons on the top of the mosque looks. It ain't the moon, it's a ram's horn. That's my suggestion. Here again, you can see the same motif. This is 1100. This is probably 1800. The motif is totally clear still, but it's transformed from being possible letters into being a mosque architectural feature. For me, it's this sliding of an iconographical motif from ornament, or from text to ornament to figuration within the context of billedforbud iconoclasm. That's kind of dazzling, but there's more. It goes back, then the calligraphic tradition take this back and actually writes its writing as architecture. This is contemporary Islamic iconography. But the whole notion of is the Shiluk pattern language, is it legible iconography, or is it pseudo-kufic, or is it a written understood message or understandable sign? I found this coin. This is from Kvarasim, just before Genghis Khan destroys this culture. Over here, hopefully you can see it, kind of very, very close to the iconography of the simple symmetrical figure, two parts in the center. And on right, it's a legible text, and it says Al-Mulk, and that's a transcription of Allah as the Lord of the world, or the King of the Kings. So my suggestion is that this coin is kind of like a Rosetta Stone. On one side you can see the King if you can't read, and the other side you can see the King if you can't read. It's a coin. Coin belongs to the king. This is a representation of the current power and God's placement in the world. So here you can also see two different coins relating to the, yeah. That was kind of I think simply want to show you something fascinating. John, there's a lot of other stuff here sustaining the relation to Central Asian iconography. I want to go back to the sheeps and the Sufis. Sorry, you can see how many hours I should have talked. Back to Anatolia. Look at this, because a special feature of all these prayer rocks in Anatolia, that is that the main chunk of them, they are depicting a red space, within the mirab. When I first looked at them, I said, it's kind of weird. I have never seen a mirab which was red in architecture. It's kind of strange. One could say, of course, it's general Turkmen identity, because red, as I told you, were the color of the steppe, the crop-like matter color. So there's some kind of identity just in the color red, and there are also, of course, some symbolic layers. But then when I listened, I was down to see the, some of the rocks in southern Turkey, and also visit the old Sufi mosque of Rumi. Rumi is he was a Sufi master from 11th century, also actually coming from Central Asia, from Afghanistan, and then going to Turkey and establishing an order, Sufi order, which became a predominant religious power in Anatolia. And they have still a tradition of the master Sufi praying on a red sheepshed. It's still going on today in Turkey. And they have a special way of orienting the sheep, and they have special connotations for the prayers in which direction the sheep are placed. And the Sufi guy, the master Sufi guy, is sitting on a red sheep's shin. Other Sufi traditions, we have also the nisha, and then some kind of skinned animal within it, and a lot of other paraphernalia. This is 1800s eon. This is Balkan contemporary nisha, sheep skins on the floor. This is eon, also Sufi tradition, with the skin on the wall and all the paraphernalia of the Sufi orders. And these are some of the old carpets again, where you see an iconography simply of a sheep. A sheep in itself is the motive of something which is made up of sheep. That's great. That's kind of mind-blowing in itself. It could be conceptual art, contemporary conceptual art, but it ain't. It's something else also. Take a look at this. This could be, of course, be simply the Turkmen orientation of the sheep's horns, but it could also be the flawed size of the sheep's skin itself. This is also totally interesting because if what you see behind, what's up there in the top, bottom, must be claws, and the pattern on the skin, it ain't a sheep, it's something else, and that else is a snow leopard, which is traditional paraphernalia both of the Sufis but also of the Mongolian Khans, which we have images of through the Timur. And this is, I have to say, all of this with the sheepskin, that's kind of my own fantasy, but I'm right, I'm sure. You can see the borders. It's kind of this type of border is not something you see anywhere else on any other rocks than prayer rocks, and it is only in the sides of the red nisha field or the nisha fields, but it doesn't make sense unless it is like this fronds from the pit in my head, because it ain't. It's an in-between between figuration and ornamentation. And that's a main feature of all the carpets. They kind of deal with an exchange between ornament and depicting something, possibly. The prayer rocks are also interesting because why I take the liberty to take them very literally regarding that this might be a motif of a sheepskin, it is because it is it's self-evident that the nisha rocks, they are figurative. They depict something. And a lot of the other carpets, you can say, it's just ornaments, it's just flowers, it's not. But the prayer rocks, they are to some extent representation, figuration. And what that figuration is, that's debatable. But they are, and in that sense, they are special and of special interest. Again, this is a whole branch of Caucasian rocks, which both depicts an architectural feature of the nisha and then depicts a snow leopard skin. This pattern in itself is terribly interesting. It's called the Shintaneni, and it can be traced all around from India to China to Turkey and back again. And I have another connection which is highly interesting regarding this specific pattern. Just want to go back. older Sufi master, Iran, 1800, colored sheepskin, Timur Sufi, snow leopard skin, 11th century, leopard skin, probably kind of romanticized photo, Iran, but still Sufi culture. The Sufi, the name itself, Sufi, it means white or wool, white wool skin, white, so. It has probably been a part of the self-identification of the Sufi as a traveler, to simply be able to both cover his body and perform prayers without having a mosque. So the Anatolian rocks, they kind of merge the Sufi notion of nomadic, non-architectural religious connotation with architecture and a structural stabilization in urban culture. So that's kind of fantastic. I'll just show you this. I've got no, I suppose we had to. Oops, sorry. But that's another. That's the Shintamani. Sorry. But please remember, this is both a look. Ornamentated Islamic writing for the Lord of the Lords. It is a sheepskin, it's an architectural representation, all merged into one card. I think I will kind of stop here and then you can ask me some questions because you should.
How do you get the carpets? Where do you get them from? And do you have like, I assume you have like a collection? How big is your collection?
I think I have Denmark's best collection. I would urge you to actually look out because the carpet market is collapsing. A lot of the interest, especially about the Turkmen carpets, it started around 1960 and peaked in around 1992 or 3. So there are a lot of the very, very good collections. They are owned by people who either themselves or their children are about to sell them. And if you Google interior decorating, just contemporary art, you see whiteness, there's no rocks. If you Google interior decorating 70s, it's all red. It's all red, rock. And I have no doubts. Younger people like you or someone else, you have to articulate something against all this boring whiteness. So the carpets will come back first into our living rooms and our environments, and then there will be some kind of home. What's a good carpet? What's a bad carpet? And then the best option that will end up on the wall again. So, I say look out for trash cans if someone throws anything out there. Because none of them can be found in Central Asia. They're gone. The last of them, then they disappeared when Soviet collapsed. So the last was sold out there, and then they went to Istanbul, and they disappeared around the mid-90s. So there's 10 times more, or 100 times more possibility of you finding a Turkmen rock in a garbage can out here or in Germany, especially in Germany and in the States, I think, then finding them in Central Asia. And of course they are fragile, and they moth, they eat them, and but their quality, they will last for 100 years if they are taken care of. But I normally find them on, depending on how good my economy is, either on eBay or on serious auctions. But these days, serious auctions are a good place to go because they can't sell them. I don't buy the carpets for their monetary value. I buy them for simply to
to have a to be in an exchange with a for me totally elastic and totally ecstatic aesthetic space, which is not contemporary art.
So you don't use them in your art practice?
Yes, I do. I do. Yes, and I have to admit more and more directly. Before I made more transformations of them, copied them into other materials. But I think my latest works, they are kind of a bit more direct, simply placing, presenting one. Because, yes.
Martin, what was your reason to run into, or how do you run into those carpets?
Yeah.
What was the beginning? Was you a child?
I think basically my notion of art is that we are trying to acknowledge phenomenologically and physically and intellectually. We are trying to, in an active way, acknowledge our world, our environments. And I'm quite sure that my own engagement with the rock started crawling around my grandfather and grandmothers, and perhaps being led or lied down or something. So it's kind of speak to a lot of layers of phenomenologically physical aspects of desire and notions of space and body, and then of course that was probably how it started as a baby, but as a grown up, I tried to react on them as a grown up. So I also tried to use my intellect in my engagement with the rocks. So, but it is still also a basic tactile pleasure. If you are welcome to touch, especially this one, something like this as well. Yes.
Well, thank you for the lecture. It's very interesting. And I will add some information to you, because I did a study in Algiers in the library of Algiers. I did a book from 1930, French anthropologist, show example how in Kilims in Bergen.
Yeah, and they're fantastic also.
How they change from figures to geometry. And so there are lots of examples. And when you first see the see the connection, it's like sea turtle, it's a very simple symbol. You can see the connection back, and then it's completely changing your... So it's quite fantastic.
And the Berber Tibon, they are very interesting regarding abstract and figurative mingling, and of course also dealing with a very direct response to modernism, which they are in a relation to.
They become
the traditions are probably
very,
very old, but they are kind of first acknowledged during late modernism. So in that sense, and then there's a feedback between modernism and the Berber table. So they are certainly, I must admit I haven't looked specifically into them, but I know they are a very interesting area also.
Yes, and I have to comment about you when you're speaking about ornaments, and they just ornaments or just flowers. I believe there is
no.
Just. Ornament is a kind of language and it's a way of speaking, and people don't do things without having any connection to it, and that you can see through all cultures and all ornaments.
Yeah.
I've been working on it for almost 30
years. Of course, totally agree.
So that is our strange Western culture
and
glasses. Putting this just in front, so we can't actually see what it's doing.
It is also kind of a... it's also a problematic approach of trying to look for a specific significance of meaning. You need a motive. You need a but all establishment of visual differences, of course, are structures which are visual language, which carries information. And then there are, and one of the, that's also why I think the rocks are interesting,
as a carrier of transformation between language, ornament, and figuration. That's also because they always work with reductions, or very easily work with reductions, that one motive or one ornament can be misread or misreproduced without losing aesthetic value, but then transforming and carrying on layers of information which even the weaver may not know is actually inherent.
So now I have to stop because, I really want to say so much thank you for a really great lecture. Okay. And I hope you can come back sometime to do the rest of the lecture, maybe stay for some days and do a workshop. I think that would be great. If you want to ask him some more questions, you can approach him now, so we can do some tutorials. But I guess you would like some lunch first.
No, yeah, that would be good. Thank you.